Hello students, Jinalisha welcomes you all on behalf of Saraswat International Academy. Today we will begin with the new chapter, chapter number 8, Cell, the Unit of Life. So students, in this chapter we will be studying regarding what is cell, which are the different types of the cell, which are the various components of the cells, that is, which are the various organelles found in the cell. So, let us begin with the introductory part of the chapter. Now, students, what is that thing through which we can differentiate a living organism from the non-living object? So, how is living organism different from non-living object? The world is formed of both living and non-living things. We know that world consists of both living and non-living things. But what is the main difference between the living and non-living things? So basically the main difference between living and non-living is the presence of the basic unit of life, the cell, in all living organisms. So how can we differentiate living and non-living objects? So basically the living organisms consist of the cell. So through the presence of cells, we can differentiate a living object from a non-living object. What is cell? So the structural and functional unit of living organisms is cell. So how can we define a cell? So basically structural and functional unit of the living organism is called cell. That is, each and every living organism is made up of cell, and it is the cell which carries out the various activities of the living organism. So we can say that cell is the structural and functional unit of living organisms. All organisms are composed of cells. Some are composed of single cell and are called unicellular organisms, while others like us are composed of many cells, are called multicellular organisms. So, based on the number of cells, there are two types of organisms. One is unicellular organism and other is multicellular organisms. Those organisms which are composed of only one type of cell are called unicellular organisms, while those organisms which are composed of many cells are called as the multicellular organism. Uni, it means single. So those organisms which are made up of single cell are called unicellular, and multi means many. So those organisms which are composed of many cells are called as multicellular organisms. Now what is a cell? Unicellular organisms, they are capable of independent existence and performing the essential functions of life. Okay. Now, those organisms which are unicellular, they are capable of independent existence. It means they have their own existence. And those organisms perform all the essential activities of the life. So, anything less than a complete structure of a cell does not ensure independent living. So basically, as I told, that unicellular organism, they are capable of independent existence. It means that a cell is important thing which enables the unicellular organism to carry out its all activity. Hence, we can say the cell is the structural and functional unit of living organisms. So how can we define a cell? A cell is the fundamental structural and functional unit of all living organism. See, multicellular organism is made up of many cells. But jo unicellular organism hai, they have their own independent existence and they are capable of performing all the essential functions of the life. So we can say that anything less than a complete structure of a cell does not ensure a independent living, which means a cell is the structural and functional unit of all the living organisms. Now, the word cell, it comes from the Latin word cellae, which means a small compartment. So the cell word is formed from the Latin word cellae, whose meaning is a small compartment. In 1665, Robert Hooke observed something which looks like a honeycomb with a great little boxes, which was later called as cells from the cork tissue. So suppose if a question is asked, who discovered cell? So basically it was for the first time Robert Hooke who observed the honeycomb like small little boxes in the cork tissue, which was later called as the cell. Anton von Leeuwenhoek, he first saw and described a live cell. Robert Brown later discovered the nucleus. These are the points regarding the history of the cell. The invention of the microscope and its improvement leading to the electron microscope revealed all the structural details of the cell. Okay, जैसे जैसे technology develop होती गई, वैसे वैसे microscopy proper होती गई. And as soon as the electron microscope was discovered, then the structural details within the cells were studied. Now, first of all, the cell theory. In 1838, Matthias Kleiden, who is a German botanist, examined a large number of plants and observed that all plants are composed of different kinds of cells which form the tissues of the plant. So, there was a German botanist named Matthias Kleiden. He observed the varieties of plant, and in that plant he observed that all the plants, jitne bhi plants usne observe kiye, he found that all the plants are composed of the different types of cells, and the group of the cells were forming the tissues of the plant. At the same time, Theodor Schwann in 1839, a British zoologist, he studied different types of animal cells and reported that the cells had a thin outer layer, which is today known as a plasma membrane. Okay, now 1838 mein Kleiden, he was a botanist. Ye time pe usse kya study kiya? Plants. And kya observe kiya? Ke each and every plant which he studied was composed of cells, and the cells were forming the tissues of the plant. Yahi time pe in approximately 1839, there was a British zoologist whose name was Theodor Schwann. So he studied different types of animal cells. Usne kiski studies ki? Animal cell ki. And what he observed? He observed that there was the presence of the thin outer layer, and that he observed that the cell was having a thin outer layer. That thin outer layer today is known as the plasma membrane. He also concluded, based on his study on plant tissues, that the presence of the cell wall is a unique character of the plants. Okay, Schwann, he was a zoologist, but on his studies, on the basis of his studies, usne thode bahut plants ko bhi study kiya. And on based on his studies on plant tissues, usne kya conclusion diya? Ki there is the presence of cell wall, and this cell wall is present only in the plant. It is absent in the animals. So Theodor Schwann ne do conclusions diye. Based on his studies on the animal cells, he said that there is a thin outer layer present, and today that thin outer layer is known as plasma membrane. And based on his studies on plant tissues, what did he conclude? He concluded that the plant cells consist of the cell wall. So presence of the cell wall is a unique character of plant cell. Cell wall, it is absent in the animal cell. So on the basis of this, Schwann proposed the hypothesis that bodies of animals and plants are composed of cells and products of cells. So Schwann ne uski jo studies thi प्लांट टिश्यूज और एनिमल टिश्यूज के पर उसके ऊपर उसने ये कंक्लूजन दिया. ही कंक्लूडेड बेस्ड ऑन हिज हाइपोथेसिस एंड बेस्ड ऑन हिज स्टडीज ही कंक्लूडेड दैट प्लांट्स एंड एनिमल्स दे आर कंपोज्ड ऑफ सेल्स एंड प्रोडक्ट्स ऑफ द सेल्स. व्हाट डिड ही कंक्लूडेड? He concluded that plants and animals are composed of cell and cellular products. Now, together, Sladen and Swan they formulated the cell theory. So, दोनों ने साथ में मिलके they gave the cell theory. So, what is according to cell theory? So, according to it, all living organisms are composed of cells and its product. And cell is the structural and functional unit of all living organism. So cell theory, it was formulated by Sladen and Swan. According to that theory, what are the important points of that theory, or what are the important observations or conclusions derived from it? So first is all the living organism, whether they are plants, animals, or microorganism, they are composed of cells and its products, and cell is the structural and functional unit of all the living organisms. Now Sladen and Swan ne jo cell theory di thi, that theory didn't explain how the new cells are formed. Unhone ye conclusion de diya tha ki living organisms they are composed of cell, but they didn't knew, or that theory didn't explain how the new cells are formed. So this theory, however, did not explain as to how new cells were formed. The cell theory given by Sladen and Swan didn't explain how the new cells are formed. Then came the another scientist, Rudolf Virchow, in 1855 first explained that the cells divided and the new cells are formed from the pre-existing cells. So in 1855 Rudolf Virchow he explained that cell divides, that is cell mein division hota hai, and the new cells are formed from the division of the pre-existing cell. So jo already cell present hai उसमें सेल डिवीजन होकर नए सेल बनते हैं. दैट इज इट इज कॉल्ड एज ओमनेस सेल्यूला ए सेल्यूला, दैट इज न्यू सेल्स आर फॉर्म्ड फ्रॉम द प्री एग्जिस्टिंग सेल. ही मॉडिफाइड द हाइपोथेसिस ऑफ Sladen एंड Swan टू गिव द सेल थियोरी अ फाइनल शेप. ओके, सेल थियोरी जो Sladen एंड Swan ने दी थी उसमें ये एक्सप्लेन नहीं किया गया था कि कैसे नए सेल्स बने. लेटर क्या हुआ, रुडोल्फ वर्चोव ने ये कंक्लूजन दिया कि न्यू सेल्स आर फॉर्म्ड फ्रॉम द प्री एग्जिस्टिंग सेल. सो रुडोल्फ वर्चोव ही फॉर्म्ड अ मॉडर्न सेल थियोरी, एंड सेल थियोरी अकॉर्डिंग टू दैट टुडे इज एक्सप्लेन्ड एज All living organisms are composed of cells and products of cells, and all cells arise from the pre-existing cell. So, Sladen and Swan की जो cell theory है उसमें थोड़ा modification लाकर Rudolf Virchow he formulated a modern cell theory, and according to that, what is it? All the living organisms they are composed of cells and products of cells. And all the cells they arise from the pre-existing cells. So that is regarding the cell theory. Now an overview of cell. So what is present within the cell? Okay, you have earlier observed cells in an onion peel and the human cheek cells under the microscope. In lower standard you might have studied the cell in an onion peel and the human cheek cell. When we consider onion cell, it is a typical plant cell, and human cheek cell is a typical animal cell. So the onion cell, which is a typical plant cell, has a distinct cell wall at its outer boundary and just within it the cell membrane. So onion cell is a plant cell. So that plant cell, we know that at its outer boundary is made up of cell wall, and inner to cell wall is the presence of the cell membrane. Whereas the cells of the human cheek have an outer membrane as a delimiting structure of the cell. So basically ह्यूमन चीक सेल है उसमें जो आउटर बाउंड्री है वो बेसिकली क्या है आउटर मेम्ब्रेन एंड दैट आउटर मेम्ब्रेन इज द सेल मेम्ब्रेन. नाउ व्हाट इज प्रेजेंट विद इन ईच सेल, व्हाट इज प्रेजेंट इंटीरियर टू द सेल. सो इनसाइड ईच सेल इज अ डेंस मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड स्ट्रक्चर कॉल्ड न्यूक्लियस. सो इनसाइड अ सेल इज द प्रेजेंस ऑफ द membranous structure or membrane bound structure which is called as a nucleus. This nucleus contain chromosomes which in turn contain the genetic material DNA. So agar plant cell hai to outer layer is cell wall, inner to cell wall is cell membrane, and if it is an animal cell then there is an outer boundary which is called as the cell membrane only. The animal cells do not contain the cell wall. Now on the interior side of the cell is a presence of membranous structure called as the nucleus. Within the nucleus is the chromosome, and this chromosome contains the genetic material which is the DNA. Now there are basically two types of the cell on the basis of basically there are three main features which differentiates the cells into prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell. So basically there are two types of cell, one is prokaryotic and eukaryotic, and this classification is based on three features. So which are the three features used in the classification of the cells into prokaryotic and eukaryotic? The first is organization of biomembranes, that is ये जो cell membrane है, cell wall है, उनका organization वो किसका बना है. Then variety of cytoplasmic organelles, that is within the cell is cytoplasm, ये cytoplasm में organelles है, so which type of organelles. And lastly the complexity of the nuclear material, यानी न्यूक्लियस कितना कॉम्प्लेक्स है. ऑन दिस थ्री फीचर्स द सेल्स आर डिवाइडेड इनटू टू बेसिक टाइप्स, वन इज प्रोकैरियोटिक सेल एंड अनदर वन इज द यूकैरियोटिक सेल. सो सेल्स दैट हैव मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड न्यूक्लियाई आर कॉल्ड एज यूकैरियोटिक सेल. सो बेसिकली दोज सेल्स के जिसमें न्यूक्लियस के सराउंडिंग मेम्ब्रेन है, that cells are called as the eukaryotic cells. Whereas the cells that lack a membrane bound nuclei are the prokaryotic cells. So jo cell mein nucleus is not surrounded by a nuclear membrane, they are called as the prokaryotic cell. So jo cell mein nucleus ke surrounding nuclear membrane nahi hai wo prokaryotic cells hai. And those cells which consist of the nuclear membrane surrounding the nucleus, they are called as the eukaryotic cells. In both prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell, a semi-fluid matrix called cytoplasm occupies the volume of the cell. So basically whether the cell is prokaryotic or eukaryotic, in both the cells there is the presence of the semi-fluid or jelly-like material which is called as the cytoplasm. The cytoplasm is the main arena, which means area of the cellular activities in both plant and animal cells. So cytoplasm is the main area of a cell where the various cellular activities takes place. हमने बोला कि cell performs various functions. So where are the various functions carried out in the cell? So basically it is carried out in the cytoplasm. Various chemical reactions occur in it to keep the cell in the living state. So basically it is the cytoplasm where the various activities or chemical reactions occur, and it keeps the cells in the living state. Purkinje in 1839 coined the term protoplasm for the sap inside the plant cell. Purkinje, he coined the term protoplasm for the sap. Is the sap means solution inside the plant cell. Now there is a little difference between the cytoplasm and protoplasm. See students, suppose here you can see that this is a cell. This part is the cytoplasm and this part is the nucleus. So cytoplasm and nucleus together is called as the protoplasm. See, protoplasm includes cytoplasm and nucleus of the cell, whereas cytoplasm, it is a jelly-like material which is present between the nucleus and the cell membrane. Ye nucleus hai and ye cell membrane hai. Ye wala jo material hai, that is cytoplasm. Protoplasm includes the nucleus, whereas cytoplasm doesn't include the nucleus. See students, this is a plant cell, this is a cell membrane, this is a vacuole, this is a nucleus, cytoplasm and cell wall. Out of that, this nucleus and the cytoplasm together is called as the protoplasm. So basically the living material of the cell is called as the protoplasm. Besides the nucleus, the eukaryotic cells have other membrane bound distinct structure or organelles which are like endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi complex, lysosomes, mitochondria, microbodies and vacuoles. So humne bola ki cell mein cell membrane hai aur beech mein nucleus hai and nucleus aur cell membrane ke beech mein cytoplasm hai. Apart from nucleus, the eukaryotic cells, they also have other membrane or you can say membrane bound organelles. सिर्फ न्यूक्लियस ही मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड नहीं है, यूकैरियोटिक सेल में दूसरे मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड ऑर्गेनल्स भी प्रेजेंट है, लाइक एंडोप्लास्मिक रेटिकुलम, गॉल्गी कॉम्प्लेक्स, लाइसोसोम्स, माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया, माइक्रोबॉडीज एंड वैक्यूल्स. वेर एज द प्रोकैरियोटिक सेल्स लैक सच मेम्ब्रेन बाउंड ऑर्गेनल्स. सी स्टूडेंट्स, द डिफरेंस बिटवीन द प्रोकैरियोटिक एंड यूकैरियोटिक सेल इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. फर्स्ट डिफरेंस इज that eukaryotic cell consists of membrane bound nuclei, whereas the prokaryotic cell doesn't contain the membrane bound nuclei. Second difference is eukaryotic cells have membrane bound organelles, whereas such membrane bound organelles are absent in the prokaryotic cells. Ribosomes are a non membrane bound organelles found in all cells, both prokaryotic as well as eukaryotic. Okay, ribosome ऐसा organelle है जो non-membrane bound है, यानी उसके surrounding membrane नहीं है, and that ribosomes are present in both the prokaryotic as well as the eukaryotic cells. Within the cell, ribosomes are found not only in the cytoplasm but also within the two organelles. One is chloroplast in plants and mitochondria and on the rough endoplasmic reticulum. So ribosome sirf cytoplasm mein nahi, but it is also present in the chloroplast and mitochondria and on the rough endoplasmic reticulum. Animal cells contain another non-membrane bound organelle called as centrosome, which helps in cell division. Now another difference between plant cell and animal cell. Plant cell mein cell wall hota hai, animal cell mein cell wall nahi hota hai, which is another difference between the plant cell and animal cell. So animal cell, it consists of another non membrane bound organelle. Ribosome ke alawa dusra ek non membrane bound organelle एनिमल सेल में प्रेजेंट है एंड दैट ऑर्गेनल इज सेंट्रोसोम एंड दिस सेंट्रोसोम इज एब्सेंट इन द प्लांट सेल. एंड व्हाट इज द फंक्शन ऑफ द सेंट्रोसोम? इट हेल्प्स इन द प्रोसेस ऑफ सेल डिवीजन. सो दैट इज द ओवरव्यू ऑफ द सेल. हमने देखा कि सेल के दो टाइप्स है, प्रोकैरियोटिक एंड यूकैरियोटिक. देन सेल आउटर लेयर में, प्लांट सेल में सेल वॉल है, वेयर एज इनर अगर एनिमल सेल है देन इट इज़ ओनली द cell membrane. Okay, apart from that, inside the cell is a presence of nucleus. If the nucleus is non-membrane bound, it is a prokaryotic cell, and if it is membrane bound, then it is a eukaryotic cell. Nucleus और cell membrane के बीच में क्या होता है? Cytoplasm. And the cytoplasm is the main area of the cell where various chemical reactions occur. Now, in the eukaryotic cell, apart from nucleus, other membrane bound organelles are also present. Okay? Then another is the ribosome, which is a non-membrane bound organelle present in both prokaryotic as well as eukaryotic cell. Animal cell, apart from ribosome, also contain another non-membrane bound organelle called as the centrosome, which helps in the cell division. And this centrosome is absent in the plant cell. Now let us study regarding the size and shape of the cell. Size of the cells. Cells differ greatly in size, shape and activities. Microplasma, the smallest cells are only 0.3 micrometer in length. Bacteria could be 3 to 5 micrometer. The largest isolated single cell is the egg of an ostrich, whose dimensions are 170 into 132 mm. Amongst the multicellular organism, human red blood cells are about 7.0 micrometer in diameter, and nerve cells are some of the longest cells. So these are the examples of the some of the cells with their dimensions. Very important thing, or this is basically for your knowledge, that basically 1 meter is equal to 10 raised to 2 centimeter, which is equal to 10 raised to 3 millimeter, which is equal to 10 raised to 6 micrometer, which is equal to 10 raised to 9 nanometer, which is equal to 10 raised to 10 angstrom. Now, shape of the cell. The cells, they also vary greatly in their shape. They may be disc-like, polygonal, columnar, cuboidal, thread-like, or even irregular. So there are varieties of the shape. Disc-shaped, polygonal shape, columnar shape, cuboidal shape, thread-like shape, or they may be even irregular in shape. And the shape of the cell may vary with the function they perform. The shape varies with the function of the cell. So these are some of the cells with their shape. See students, these are the RBCs, these are the white blood cells, these are the columnar epithelial cell, this is a nerve cell, this is a tracheid, and this is a mesophyll cell. So these are some of the cells with their shape. Today I end my lecture here. In the next lecture, we will be studying variety of the organelles found in the cell, as well as we will be studying in detail the structure of the prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell. Thank you, students.